Welcome, or welcome back for some of you to Grandview. I'm Russ Weatherall. I'm lucky enough to be president here. And it's nice to have, this is a great weekend to see so many folks that have been here and have so much history. And history's why we're here. Before I introduce the person who will introduce Dr. Laws, just a couple words about this building that we're sitting in. This building is, I think, about 30 years or so. So this probably came after some of you were here, but some of you might have experienced it now and then. But we are in the middle of a project, in case you're overcome with a bout of philanthropy or whatever, you know, to want to help us. But we're in a project to totally redo this building. And it's a long time coming, and it's going to be pretty neat, including this room, which unfortunately, this is not the up-to-date, state-of-the-art screen that we have here, but before too long we'll have that, so that's pretty neat. And the project and things that are happening are all within the purview of the Grandview Foundation. And the woman who makes the Grandview Foundation go is Kelly Fackel. If you haven't communicated with her or heard from her, this is her. And she put this whole weekend together for our 90th anniversary, which is a lot of fun and a lot of neat things happening already this year. And we'll cap off with the holiday party in December, so if you're able to come to that, please do. That'll be a little extra blowout, I think, this year, so that'll be a lot of fun. So Kelly Fackel will introduce our speaker.
Full of happiness seeing you all here. Thank you so much for being with us and for all you did to make Grandview the great place that it continues to be today. Russ said I make this go. That is not entirely true because Janie up there in the green, all the girls in the green help make it go. Yeah. So we have a great team and we're just so grateful to get to serve this hospital. So I'm introducing one of my favorite people in the world today, and Dr. Laws and I, I've been working here maybe 14 years, and I met Dr. Laws about 10 years ago, maybe a little longer than 10 years ago, when we were getting ready to celebrate the 80th anniversary of the hospital. Many of you came to that celebration. We had a big dinner at the Dayton Country Club, and we wrote a book. Dr. Laws is sort of the historian, as you all know, of Grandview's records and all interesting stories, and he told me he was going to write a book, and you know, he was a little busy being a cardiologist, so we hired an author to go around and interview people, interview physicians, as many people we could talk to that were willing to sit down and interview with us, and we wrote a book, and after the lecture tonight, there's a book, it's called Patients and Patients, A History of Grandview Hospital. There'll be a book for anybody that wants one, and Dr. Laws will sign them before you leave. And it's a fun read. All our new employees get the book, and everybody really, really likes the stories and the pictures, and it's great. But Dr. Laws, and we are recording this lecture tonight too, so if you want to, you know, watch it again, or somebody's not here, you want to share it with them, we'll be putting that on our website, and we can make copies for anybody who wants one. Now, Dr. Laws, we're celebrating 90 years this year, and I think you told me that you've been at least 45 years, I think it's 46 though, of Grandview's 90. So half of Grandview is right here with us tonight. Dr. Laws still serves as Grandview's and Southview's Director of Cardiac Services, and in addition to being an amazing physician, I see many of his patients here tonight. He's a humanitarian. He was heavily involved with some humanitarian work in just terrible places around the world who are struggling. And he's in an award-winning documentary called Beyond the Call. We screened that several years ago. But I think his hobby is history. So tonight he's going to be telling us all sorts of things about the wonderful history of this place. And I do want to introduce my other favorite person, Pat, his lovely wife, Pat, and tonight from out of town, we've got his son, Marcus, who's up there, his wife, Leslie, and their grandson, Wesley. So this is really a nice treat to have everybody here along with all of you. So without further ado, Dr. Laws.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure for me to be with a lot of osteopaths and their families and their friends. And when I first came to Grandview, there were a lot of old-timers that had practiced at Second Street. And it was like when you were in the Army, back in the old Army, back in the old Army. And it was like back at Second Street. This is the way it was back at Second Street. Like that was where the real medicine was practiced. So it got me to thinking, well, how did this come to be? All these buildings and projects that make up Grandview Hospital. And so I began to dig into the background. And thankfully, Grandview has published multitudes of little newspapers. And that goes back even to Second Street. There was one called Corridor Gossips. There was the Osteopatter. There was the Grandview News. There were just a host of these newspapers. And a lot of what we have to show you tonight came out of that material. And that's how I was able to get this information together. Now, I think you have to begin with the osteopaths if you're going to talk about Grandview. And the very first osteopath in the area was a guy by the name of Gravitz, H.H. Gravitz, and he settled over in Greenville. And he was promptly arrested for practicing without a license. And so he had to go to court here in the state of Ohio, and lo and behold, he won his court case, and we actually are practicing here in this state because of good old H.H. Gravitt that won that case. Also, there was a fellow by the name of Rensburg who actually practiced here in Dayton. W.J. Rensberger. Now he didn't practice here but a couple of years, and then he left and went out to the West Coast, and I'm not sure what happened to him after that. Also, I missed on my PowerPoint, but Herman Steele was here. He was one of the sons of Andrew Taylor Steele. He practiced in Dayton for a couple of years and went back to Kirksville and just was involved in their teaching program at the Kirksville College. Now, E.H. Cosner was practicing here from the very early years. The earliest telephone book I was able to get my hands on was the 1919 Dayton telephone book, and he's in that telephone book. I actually took care of his son, who later became an osteopath, and E.H. Cosner started the Dayton Osteopathic Society, which is still in effect to this very day. Now, H.H. Gravitt had a brother named W.A. Gravitt, and W.A. Gravitt bought a house on Second Street and started a clinic called the Miami Clinic, and it is from that beginning at the Miami Clinic that Grandview Hospital began. Actually, he sold that building to a number of osteopaths in the 1930s. Actually 1926, and it became the Dayton Osteopathic Hospital. It had been known as the Miami Clinic prior to that. Now, I don't know what happened to my 1919 yellow pages of the Dayton telephone book, but this is the 1920 yellow pages, and we were listed as osteopathists in the yellow pages, and we were listed just underneath Ornamental Ironworks and just in front of Oysters. We weren't listed with the regular doctors in town, okay? Now, 1 year later, there were several other osteopaths that had come to Dayton, and as a matter of fact, the very first female physician in Dayton, Ohio was Elizabeth Leonard, who, according to this telephone book, began practice here in 1921. And again, we were underneath ornamental plastering and somewhere ahead of the oysters, and it said sea fish. So I don't know what they were thinking about us, but we weren't held in the highest esteem. This is a picture of a group of physicians, osteopathic physicians, that got together once a week and met downtown at one of the hotels for an educational program at noon. So this is 1939, that's 1 year after my birth. And there are several people, and here's E.H. Cosner, who began the Osteopathic Society. Here is Dr. Stout, who was practicing also in 1919. And there is Elizabeth Leonard. And by that time, Dr. Hutchinson had also come into the area, and I think she is probably the second female physician in the Dayton area. Now, this is the front cover of the Journal of the American Osteopathic Association in 1926 in September. And note that somebody had written on the front of the cover page 44 and page 76 and 77. And so if you open to those pages, here is the Miami Clinic. It's in a hospital on 2nd Street. It listed all the staff members, and then it listed what services that the hospital was able to provide for the patients there. Now, this house had been built by a gentleman that owned a lumber yard here in Dayton, and he had access to all types of lumber, and so he saw to it that the wood trimmings in each room was built with different types of lumber. So there was no room that had the same wood trimmings in it. And this is the entranceway to that house, and this is now the entranceway to the Miami Clinic, which became the Dayton Osteopathic Hospital, 325 West 2nd Street, Dayton, Ohio. And you can see the ornamental wood that was there in the front foyer. Now, each room was a patient room, had a single patient in each room when they started. I think it started with 5 beds, ultimately up to 44 beds. Each of these rooms had different types of wood, as I had mentioned before. Each of them had windows that opened to the outside. It was a very airy type patient situation. And at that time, apparently, there was a trend to try to make the hospital a more home-like and patient-friendly. And you can see the chairs and desks and things that were in each of the rooms that made it a much more homey atmosphere for the patients. Now, this was an osteopathic hospital, and you're not going to get very far away from osteopathic therapy. Here was their table in that hospital. This was a World War I surplus x-ray machine. This is their obstetrics unit, and this is their surgery. No, I'm sorry, this is the laboratory. Now, the lab was in the basement of the hospital, and this is a man by the name of Charles Horsch. Charlie Horsch was still head of the lab when I came here in 1971. His son became an osteopathic physician and was trained as an orthopedic surgeon here at Grandview. And this is the surgery. Now, that table wound up out at the racetrack in Lebanon, and I have tried desperately to find that table, and I have not been able to do so. It also was World War I surplus. Now, this again is one of those newspapers published by the hospital, and I put it in here to show you the types of physicians that were starting this hospital, because I think we have to look back at where did we come from and what was really going on in our hospital. So this is a patient of Dr. Dillertush, and it was a female child. The baby was born February the 29th, 1944. Now I think that if my addition is correct, that's 72 years ago. And shortly after, the baby weighed 12 pounds and 9 ounces. And shortly after delivery, the baby's bowel herniated through the umbilicus and out into the umbilical cord, and ultimately ruptured the umbilical cord, and the entire bowel content were outside the body of the infant. And you have to realize there was a very small, tight opening, and so it compromised the blood supply to this infant. And immediately at that time, they noticed that the female, the mother, had lacerated her cervix, and she was hemorrhaging severely. And so Dr. Dillertush had to turn his attention to the mother. So he placed the infant in a pan, he covered him over with a moist towel, and it took him about 45 minutes to stop the hemorrhaging in the mother. And then he turned his attention to the infant, and by that time the bowel had turned blue and gas had built up, and so there were just, here was this huge colon and small bowel full of gas outside the belly. So he opened this infant from the xiphoid process to the pubic bone, and he still could not get the bowel back into the baby's abdominal cavity. So he then took a large syringe and a big needle, and he aspirated the air out of the colon and the small bowel, and he was able to deflate that and get the colon and bowel back into the infant's cavity and close the wound. Now, it does say that he put some sulfa powder inside the wound. Now, that was still quite common when I was in Kansas City in 1966 or 67. Most surgeries got, if you had the abdominal cavity open, they put some sulfa powder in there. I don't know whether it did him any good or not, but mother and infant both survived and went home safe. And I think to this very day, how would they handle that case out of Southview if they had that kind of emergency at one of their deliveries today? It would be a tough case. And that's the kind of people that helped to build this hospital. Now, by 1947, they had just outgrown that building on 2nd Street. I told you it started with 5 beds. And by 1947, they were up to 44 beds. So they built this hospital and moved 44 beds here at the opening. And they left 23 beds that were all maternity beds on 2nd Street. So for a short period of time, there were two osteopathic hospitals here in Dayton city limits, one down on 2nd Street and one out here on Grand Avenue. And when they moved those 23 beds over here in July, they had a total bed capacity of 67 beds here at Grandview. Now, they were already busting at the seams, so in January of 49, they went down in the basement, they remodeled that, they got 23 new beds out of that remodeling period, and they now were up to a total of 90 beds. So in 1947, they had a 50% increase in their bed capacity, and by 1949, they had another 33% increase in the beds. Now, here are some of the early pictures of the construction project here at Grandview on this present site. Now, this land was purchased before World War II, and the WPA stopped all construction. So nurses, physicians, and other employees used this ground for victory gardens during the World War II period. And I think you can see the church on the corner, and Grand Avenue is right here. Now, I want to call your attention to something here, because this is in one of the Grandview newspapers. The B.G. Danis Construction Company was doing that project. So I want to show you now a picture I took just recently of the most recent construction project here. And I think you can see the Danis Company was involved in that. And I think they were involved in the majority of the projects that we're going to go over today. Now, this is the way the hospital set in 1947. It was way back from Grand Avenue, and it took me a long time to realize why it was and how did that come to be that it set so far back, until I ran into one of the newspapers of our hospital, and I knew the hospital had been built as an H-shaped structure, but I'd never seen any pictures of it until this picture. And here you can see a good idea that didn't work, because this was the proposal was to add two stories on the top of the first one-story building that had been built in 1947. They were going to build up two more stories on top of it. Well, guess what? They hadn't planned properly, so they didn't build enough foundation, so they couldn't put the two stories on top of the original one-story hospital. So that was a good idea that didn't work. Now, here is the, off to the right there, is the intern quarters, or intern lounge and quarters. And I always wondered, well, why is it that it's kind of cattywampus there? It isn't straight or it isn't square. Well, it turns out that the codes and building codes in Dayton say you can't take your building but within so many feet of your property line. So they didn't own that property over there, and if they had straightened that out, they would have not been able to build the project. So they made a current turn in the building and added that intern quarters there. But anyway, by 1952, again, they were faced with crisis in beds. And they couldn't put the two stories on top of the one that they had already built, so they went out in front of the hospital and built a three-story structure. So there's the 1947 building, the original Grandview Hospital, sitting behind this 1952 structure. So here's Grandview Avenue, and this addition added 80 beds. So they were able to come to a total of 170 beds. By 1957, again, they were having bed problems, so they built a maternity wing. And the maternity wing was a freestanding building connected with a hall to the Grandview Hospital. It added 55 beds, so they came to a total of 225, and that was a one-third increase. Now, in 1947, when they moved to this spot, there were 788 babies born in Grandview Hospital. In 1957, there were 1,792 births. Now, that's about that's five births a day, 365 days a year. Now, this was the middle of the baby boom, and this is one of the things that drove the growth of Grandview Hospital. Almost all of the physicians delivered babies back then. If you delivered a baby, grandmama and granddaddy, if they got sick, they came to you, and you wound up at Grandview Hospital. And so the practices just kept growing and getting bigger, and that's why we had to have these building projects, one after the other, to keep increasing the number of beds available for patients. So here's the 52 building, three-story structure, and behind it would be the 1947 building. Now by 1962, again out of beds, so they added, and this time they did think far enough ahead, and they were able to add on to the foundation another two stories on top of the 1952 building, and they added 76 beds, bringing the total to 301 beds, and that's another one-third increase in the bed capacity for our hospital. So there's the 62 building. Here is the 52, the first three stories, the 57 maternity wing, and back behind there is the 1947 original Grandview Hospital. So here is an aerial photograph from close to that period of time. 1947, you had that H-shaped structure. Here is that intern quarters and lounge. Now by 1952, they added three stories out in front, came closer to Grandview Avenue. By 1957, they had the maternity wing, freestanding building. Then in 62, they added two stories to the top of the original 52 building. Another two stories. When I walked into Grandview, this is the way it looked, 1957, because there was a building project of late 1969, 1970, where they added 66 beds. They had their first real ICU. Up until that time, they had just taken a patient room and put some monitors in there and called it an ICU. But here in this project in 1969, the first true ICU, they had a brand new surgery. By the way, that new surgery is where our present cath lab is. And they built a brand new emergency room, and they added a number of beds and brought the total bed capacity up to, they had 66 new beds, brought it up to 367 beds. And that's the way it looked when I began my residency here in Grandview Hospital. So there's 5262, and there is the 1970 addition. And here is an aerial photograph from that period of time. There's the original structure, 44 beds with the 23 maternity beds, and in 49 they added another 23. It was H-shaped. Out in front they built the three stories in 52 and the maternity wing in 57, and on top of that in 62 they had another two stories. And in 1970 they had the big addition with the new ICU, the new surgery, and a new emergency room. And then Dr. Burns, who's sitting here, when I came to apply for my residency, took me on a tour of the hospital. And the annex hadn't been opened yet, and we went through a tunnel, and actually it had just wooden pieces of wood with mud and everything. We had to pick our way through there. But there is a tunnel, as most of you know, that goes from the Grandview Hospital over to the annex. And in 1972, that annex was opened. It added 85 beds, and at that time, Grandview Hospital had 452 beds, which made it the largest osteopathic hospital under one roof in the United States of America. Now, in order to open that annex, there was a lot of consternation by the neighbors because people were parking in their driveway and coming to visit patients. The streets were jammed with visitors' cars, and so the city said you had to build a parking garage, and so that was built in 72 to allow us to open the annex with those extra 85 beds. Now in 1984, the project began of the hospital that we presently practice in, where the main beds are. That was started in 1984. So there's the 47 project, 52, 57, 62, 70, 72, and then the 1984 project. Here it is completed, 47, 52, 57, 62, 70, 72. You can see it just scattering us out and surrounding the original project. So there was a building built by three physicians. I think it was Quinn Levin and Hours and Dager. I think that's who I thought it was anyway. Built this building that's right behind where I'm standing now, that faces out on Grand Avenue, and the hospital purchased that in 1983. And in 1984, when the new project was opened, they closed the annex. So the annex was closed, all the beds went in to the main hospital structure that we practice in today. And in 84, they also built the office building. That's where my office is to this day. And in 1987, this building was dedicated by Ohio University, as was mentioned just earlier. And they're going to redo it now. The next picture is going to be taken from that window where that little circle is. That's on the fourth floor of the main hospital building. And I never did realize, but that's looking down on the top of the original H-shaped structure of the Grandview Hospital. I did not understand that for a long, long time while I was here at Grandview. But that's the original 1947 structure. And so here would be the 52. The bottom three stories would be 52, and it's connected by a hallway going forward towards Grandview Avenue, or Grand Avenue, from the original structure. Here's the maternity wing, and here's the 62, two additions on top. Now, this part of the original hospital was destroyed. That's the first destruction of any structure here in the present building project, and that's pretty close to where the new entranceway for the hospital is. And the next picture is going to be taken from the top of the maternity wing, and we're looking towards the 1984. Remember, we were here looking down on the top of the hospital. So there's the original 1947 structure. Here's the maternity wing. That's the 84 hospital that we're practicing now. There's the 70 addition, and out in front of it would be the 62-52 additions. And that part of the hospital went away, as did the maternity wing, during this last construction project. So the next picture is going to be from the roof of the 1984 building, and we're looking down. Here is the parking garage. Here's the mechanical building. There's the roof of the 84 building, and then the new construction, which is now open. That's our west wing. And here you can see some of the construction going on. We were up there for the last picture. This 57 maternity wing was taken down. It no longer exists. The new entrance for the hospital is in this general area here. And this is an artist's conception of what we were going to have for our new building project. So there's the 84 building, and that maternity wing was right here, which went away. And there is the new construction project. 52 is the bottom of that building, and the 62 is the top part of it. And this is a little overlay map, and it shows you in the center the original hospital, and then out in front, that was in 47, out in front of it then is the 62 and the 52 building of five stories, three in 52 and two further stories in 62. And then off to the left is the maternity wing, which is in 57. Here is the 1970. Now, they got it wrong. This building was 1969-70, and notice they had it 71. And then they had the 84 building. Now, here is our new construction. Well, there's the parking garage and the mechanical building. And here is the new construction. And if you remember, in the hospital, we had this big atrium that went six floors. It was open, and I think there was at least one either attempted suicide or completed suicide, somebody going over that. And that all went away during this building project and has become floor space for the hospital at this time. That was in that area right there. And here is our new entranceway to the hospital. And another artist drawing, the 84 building, 57, 62, 62, 47 building behind it. That went away, and there's our new west wing. And here's a new entranceway. And at this artist drawing, they didn't know exactly what it was going to look like. And here are some pictures of the destruction of the maternity wing. And it was torn down. And also one wing of the H-shaped structure of the original 47 hospital, which was there, it went away, and all that made room for the new opening to the new entranceway for our hospital. And here is a very recent picture, 2014. There's the 62 building. Behind that now is the 47 building, the original structure. If you went further around to the right, it would be the 1970. There's the 84, is the big tall structure where most of the hospital beds are today. Now, I asked for an aerial photograph, and Kelly got me this, and this is kind of cool. They had a little drone. Didn't you have a little drone? Photographic drone, and so they ran that thing up in the air and took me a picture. I think it's kind of cool that they do that for me. But here's your original hospital, 1947. That part of it was torn down, and the new entranceway to the hospital is there, as you can see. Here is the west wing that just opened up. Here is the 6252 building, and the maternity wing no longer exists. It's a driveway. Here's the 1970 building project, and there's the 1984 project. Now, in 1978, a new theory about how to take care of sick patients came into being in America, and they tried to make it into a hospital without beds. It was a cost reduction theory, okay, hospital without beds. So out at where Southview Hospital is today, there was complete surgery, a complete lab, complete pharmacy, complete emergency room, doctor's offices, everything that could possibly, x-ray, complete x-ray, everything that could be there to support a hospital was there. There just weren't any hospital beds. But ultimately, I believe it was 55 beds were taken away from this structure here, placed down at Southview, and the new Southview Hospital came into existence in 1983. Now, you can't discuss the growth and the development of Grandview Hospital without talking about the education program. Just can't be done. If you go through this hospital, anywhere you want to go through, you're going to see scenes like that where young doctors are being taught their art. Now, how did this all come to be? Why did Grandview become such an educational center? This is back in the 50s, late 50s. Some of the physicians here at Grandview decided to take various ways that we treated disease process and go on the road in America and present our treatment methods to other osteopathic hospitals. Now, this happened to be on breast cancer, I think. And they had radiologists. Fox and Baudette were two very fine radiologists here. Alvarado was a very fine pathologist. Esselman was an internist, and Elliott was the surgeon. So these gentlemen went out and they would go over breast cancer. Here's how we diagnose it. Here's how we determine what should be done about it. Here's how we treat it medically, and here's how we treat it surgically. Now, these things were great successes, and people saw that in these other hospitals, and they wanted to come here to be trained. So if they had students or young doctors there, they wanted to come and have their residency here at Grandview or their internship here at Grandview Hospital. And actually, from this type of training, from these cancer programs, came the tumor board that exists to this very day here at Grandview. Now, the other thing you have to realize is that this really did lead to a dramatic increase in people wanting to come here to be trained. Now, this is 1951, I think, and this intern class had 150 applicants for the internships here at Grandview. Do you know how many interns they had? They had 10 interns. So there were 15 applicants for every spot for training here at Grandview. And that just drove this hospital to build and to have more and more sick people in it. More doctors came here. And I'm just going to go over some of this, okay? So this is a class, 1955-1960. Donald G. Burns was in that class. All right? There were 14 interns. How many are there now? 105 or something, I don't know, 30 I think. But there were 14, and they had 102 applicants for those slots, for those 14 slots. Now, the important thing to pick up from this, Donald G. Burns stayed here. He stayed at Grandview. He started the pulmonary department here. He started a pulmonary fellowship. He trained osteopathic physicians, and they went out all over America and taught, and believe me, they said nothing but good about Grandview. John Vossler. John Vossler went out to Preble County. Today, three of his children are out there pumping hundreds of patients into this hospital every day. Samson. Samson went out to Middletown, big general practice, pumped patients into this hospital until he stopped practicing. John Thiesing went out to Centerville, did the same thing, big practice. And Thomas McCarthy up here on North Main Street, huge practice, hundreds and hundreds of patients came into Grandview Hospital. Well, 14 interns, 5 stayed at Grandview. That's better than one-third of that class stayed here and helped to build this hospital. All was not goodness and light, okay? So they had applied for another, they had applied for an anesthesia residency, one more intern or internal medicine residency, and one surgical residency. They had an internal medicine residency and a surgery, I think, at that time. And the Bureau of Hospitals sent a report. It was a 16-page report. I'm just going to show you a little of it. And denied Grandview Hospital any of these residencies in anesthesia, internal medicine, and surgery. Why did they deny these residencies? They said you weren't teaching the interns good enough. Now, this was one of the best hospitals in the nation, the osteopathic type. And yet we weren't good enough for the Bureau of Hospitals to allow us to have these other residencies. And so the hospital was quite concerned about it. Said, well, what in the heck can we do about this? And so that was what this report was about. And they went to the constitution and bylaws of the hospital. They went to the entire corporate structure of the hospital. They went to the president of the board, all of the administrators, all the department heads in the hospital, they went to all the staff members, they went through all of the inspections the hospital had had recently, and man, they reshaped this hospital from the ground up. They talked about how we didn't take interns on ward rounds. They talked about how the internal medicine department didn't consult surgery and how surgery didn't consult internal medicine. These were some important things for the Bureau of Hospitals. And they said, you're going to have to get this straight before we will allow you to have these residencies. And the hospital did that. And they reshaped the entire corporate structure. And from this came the staff executive committee of Grandview Hospital. They call it something else now. I don't even know what they call it, but it was the staff executive committee for the entire time I've been here at Grandview. So I don't think you can deny if a hospital is going to change its entire corporate structure, its entire staff structure, just to maintain the educational program, then the educational program is one of the most important things that can be here in this hospital. So from the very start, and I showed you that case of Dilatush with that baby's bowel herniating out. Excellent physicians here in the hospital. They gave excellent critical care that led to large volumes for teaching. They had excellent intern resident training programs. What does that do? That attracts more interns and residents. And what happens there? They stay here. So they join the staff, and what does that do? More patients coming into the hospital, increasing the volume. And that leads to a stronger hospital, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it's all based on the educational program here at this hospital. And the excellent students that we're able to attract. Now, here's a class, 1972. All right, Dominic Maga. Trained in internal medicine. I know, it's over the IRS. But he stayed here, brought a lot of patients in here, and he's practicing emergency medicine now. David Deere. David Deere was trained as an anesthesiologist, stayed here for years, and practiced anesthesia. I think he went up to the Great Lakes when he got tired of hard work. Jimmy Seal. Jimmy Seal was my senior resident when I came here. Stayed in practice until his death. Don Stamper became a general practitioner. So did Stephen Blumhoff. Allison Clary, one of the chief surgeons in our profession. And Cleanne Cass, I think, is running the hospice of Dayton right to this day. And James Laws decided to be a cardiologist. But if you look at this class, there are 23 physicians sitting there, and 8 of them stayed at Grandview. Now that's still 1/3, and that's been happening over and over and over again. And that's what has led to the strength of the hospital. So here is the way it was in 1926. And here is the way it is today. And I think we've come a long way, baby. And I think that's the end of this lecture, okay? So certainly I'll be happy to answer questions. I don't know if I can have the correct answer, but I'll probably lie. Are there any questions?
What happened to the intern building?
I think some of it's still there. You know where you go down that little ramp?
Yeah.
I think that's it right there. And you run into where the EKG department is. I think it's that corner right there.
Where the old ER used to be?
Where the old ER used to be, yeah. Okay. I'm pretty sure that, I know that's the general location, okay. Don, you know?
I had a comment. In 1947, when they opened the building here, they weren't flooded with applications for internship, and they wanted to take 2 interns. And so what happened was, one of the folks here, who was on one of the committees looking for interns, happened to be over at Doctor's Hospital in Columbus, and noticed an application to Doctors for an internship laying on some administrator's desk. So when nobody was looking, they lifted that, brought it back to Grandview, and then wrote to that young doctor and said, "You've been accepted for an internship."
Is that your daddy?
You. And that's how my dad got here.
I think he told me that story a long time ago.
We're talking about the fact that we could not go up. Reminds me of a breakfast that I had during my internship when Augenstein was on the board and a member of the staff. We sat in a cafeteria on the first floor. He said, we can only go 1 floor above this. And the reason was we did not have enough money to put steel so we could go higher than 1 floor. We needed $25,000.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you that every one of these projects, the money was raised right from this staff, a big part of it. And they then started selling bonds. And all of those were sold to friends and people like that. And they did hire, there was a woman. Who is the woman? I've been trying to think of her name. Who got her? Got her name attached to where you give gifts to children.
Oh, Ruth Lyons.
What's her name?
Ruth Lyons.
She was hired, I think, at one time by the hospital to be their coach for how to, you know, to sell the bonds and raise the money. But they, now, I think Mary Theodorus told me that she was able to get some money from one of the people that very close, or either was one of the Wright brothers are one of their very close relatives, okay? Did you hear that story here?
One Huber.
Which
one? Huber? The Huber.
I may have been. I don't know. I've forgotten. I'm getting older and going south. Any other questions? Yeah?
One other thing, Jim. You mentioned about ICU. 2 doctors started that. One of them is here. Don Berg.
Yeah.
He's my teacher.
Okay.
For sure. And that's the thing, that's the glue that holds this whole thing together. I mean, everybody is to get everybody. We're crossbred to the nth degree. There's no doubt about it.
I thought an interesting thing was that I'm not quite certain when they may have quit doing this, but the hospital would assess you $1 per day per patient who had the hospital. And that money went to the hospital.
I've seen it in some of the things and heard about it, but I don't know any of the history on that.
And then when the parking garage was built, I'm not real certain the figures, but I think it was $5,000 per surgeon they had to pay, and the internist anyway had to pay, I think it was $3,000.
Well, I know the surgeons used to have to buy their own instruments.
Yeah.
That was a heck of an output of cash, you know.
I remember when the hospital only got $50 a day from Blue Cross, Blue Shield, or something of that order for each patient, you know. And we were on the short end of the stick, you know. I know when they gave out money compared to the MD hospitals, you know.
Just in front of Fish. Just behind Arnold Mill Arms. But it keeps us humble.
Jim.
This is a question for the future. Being we're with Kettering Hospital, Kettering Medical Center, and what's going to happen to the DO profession? And what you've been talking about here all afternoon in the future. Are we going to keep our...
I don't know. We have a very strong board, or what do they call it, the educational...
Foundation.
Foundation for them, but there's a big change coming, or maybe already has come, in how people are certified in their education, and who does the picking and choosing, is that correct, Paul?
Yeah. Yeah, Harvey, do you want to answer Ross? Go ahead.
Well, go ahead.
What they've done now is, the AOA had their accreditation for residencies, and the AMA had their accreditation for residencies. The federal government said they weren't going to pay for two accreditation systems for residency, not accreditation for your specialty, just the residency. So the federal government said you could come together and they form what's called a single accreditation system. Now, we have a number of residencies here. In every one of our residencies, we are now asking for accreditation through the single accreditation system with an osteopathic focus. So we will keep that osteopathic heritage alive in all of our residencies. That will also mean, so that we're not discriminating, that we may have to take some MDs into our residencies, but they're going to have to show some kind of osteopathic growth or knowledge before they come into our programs. So it is in one program now for residency. Then after your residency, you then can then get board certified either on the osteopathic side or the allopathic side. We would hope that everybody who takes an osteopathic residency would do the osteopathic residency and osteopathic certification then. So that's how we're working on that. And believe me, we're going to put a lot of money into this. There's no question about it. Because there are a lot of differences between ACGME MD accredited residencies and our AOA residencies. And we've made a commitment that we will put those dollars in, hire new faculty, more faculty, and make it a better program, just like Dr. Laws was saying, which is the basic backbone of this entire institution. Russ, if you've got anything else to offer?
No, just that the actual residency, we use the term slots, if you hear that, but residency positions, that's not changing. And those residency positions, which we're paid for about 85 to 90 positions, we actually have about 130 residents associated with Grandview. That part's not changing. It's just the accreditation part that's changing. So as long as the federal government doesn't change that part of the picture, those residencies will be associated with Grandview.
One other thing, we have a strong advocate on the education committee nationally is Bob King, one of Dr. Burns' residents.
Yeah, he's in Columbus now, is that where he is?
Right.
Listen, Kelly Fackel said it might be a good idea, since we've had so many guys here from the hospital that don't get together very often, if you've been trained here, could you come on down? We'll try to get some pictures all together.
And gals. Kind of nice and gals.
Huh?
Just gals, too.
And gal, yeah. And I think I told me in the train. I'm old.
Article about Randy, they were looking at a different parcel of land, and it was actually at Central and Plymouth, which is up Grand Avenue away, you know where Central is. So I thought that was kind of interesting.
There were several parcels apparently were looked at, but this was the one that they chose. But I didn't know that particular one for sure. Okay, if you guys could come on down, we'll get, and gal.